So it's wonderful to see a packed hall here. I'm really delighted that we've got this opportunity to come here and present this film. This happens to be 2019, happens to be the birth centenary of my father, Kaifi Azmi. And we've done many things to celebrate him. I think of that, the most important is Kaifinama, because it really encapsulates his spirit through his work, through his poetry. And I think in today's day, it is really important to revisit people who were involved with the progressive writers movement, people who believed that art should be used as an instrument for social change. In celebrating Kaifi, we celebrate his times and we celebrate that manifesto which came into being at the Progressive Writers Conference held by Premchand. But of course, the beginning was Sajjad Zahir and Sardar Jafri and Mulk and people like that. So normally what we do is, before we show the film, I recite some of Kaifisaab's poems, and Sumantra is also a poet, and also he's done the marvelous job of translating some of these poems. Of course, I always say that translating a poem is like pouring perfume from one bottle into the other. Some of the fragrance is bound to be lost. But with Sumantra's translation, I think what is very important is he keeps the spirit, and apart from that, it also works as a poem independently in English. So if you have your permission, when I say permission, then you have to say it, of course. If not, then you have to keep quiet. Let's learn Urdu tehzeeb ke bare mein bhi kuch seekhe. So actually, when I say मैं कहूँ तो इजाजत है तो आपको कहना चाहिए इरशाद कहिए. वेरी गुड, वेलकम. अच्छा, ये जो ऑर्डर है ये ऑर्डर डायरेक्टर साहब ने चूज किया है, मैंने नहीं किया, लेकिन फर्मा बरदार गुड एक्टर हु बिलीव्स इन अ डायरेक्टर, सो दैट्स व्हाई आई एम जस्ट फॉलोइंग हिज ऑर्डर्स. इफ यू डोंट लाइक इट यू हैव हिम टू ब्लेम. सो द फर्स्ट poem is तो आप बताइए क्यों आपने पशिमानी चूज किया?
पशिमानी is about regret, but if you we have three love poems, and I think what is extraordinary about Kaifisaab is the range and the movement of his poetry over his life, and so पशिमानी is an early poem where he talks about a lost love. So I think it is something, I chose it because I think it's something that all of us, I hope, have gone through at some point. And therefore will...
That means you feel all of us should have lost someone, not just you.
Well, I'm presuming that we have other humans here. So basically I chose that because I thought it is what happens to you when you're very young, though it can translate into you in to an elder age as well. And then the movement of the love poetry is into celebration, and then into a maturing of a kind that is extraordinary, which is both personal and universal. We'll come to that later, but that's why Pashimani.
This also figured as a song in Chetananand's film Haqeeqat. Main ye soch kar uske dar se utha tha कि वो रोक लेगी, मना लेगी मुझको. मैं ये सोचकर उसके दर से उठा था कि वो रोक लेगी, मना लेगी मुझको. हवाओं में लहरा था, आता था दामन, कि दामन पकड़कर बिठा लेगी मुझको. कदम ऐसे अंदाज से उठ रहे थे कि आवाज देकर बुला लेगी मुझको, मगर उसने रोका न मुझको मनाया. न दामन ही पकड़ा, न मुझको बिठाया, न आवाज ही दी, न वापस बुलाया. मैं आहिस्ता आहिस्ता बढ़ता ही आया, यहां तक कि उससे जुदा हो गया मैं. शुक्रिया, ये आपने सही बोला. quick learners.
I got up to leave, thinking this. She would stop me. She would call me back. A gust of wind billowed my clothes. Ah, I thought, all the better for her to hold on to them. My steps were hesitant, uncertain. She would call me back, surely. Truth is, she neither stopped me nor coaxed me to stay. She did not clutch at me nor asked me to linger. She said nothing, didn't call me back, and I walked slowly on. Walked so far that we are separate now.
Because there's so many poems of his which are romantic. So why have you chosen this one?
I think if I tell you what that means, you'll know. Ek bosa is a kiss. Need I say more?
Jab bhi chum leta hoon in haseen aankhon ko, sau charaag andheron mein jhil milane lagte hain. Jab bhi chum leta hoon in haseen aankhon mein, sau charaag andheron mein jhil milane lagte hain. Phool kya, shagufe kya, chand kya, sitare kya. Phool kya, shagufe kya, chand kya, sitare kya. Sab raqeeb qadmon par sar chukane lagte hain. Raqs karne lagti hain moorte ajanta ki. Muddaton ki lab basta ghar jaane lagte hain, gaane lagte hain. Phool khilne lagte hain ujde ujde gulshan mein. प्यासी प्यासी धरती पर अब्र छाने लगते हैं. लम्हे भर को ये दुनिया जुल्म छोड़ देती है. लम्हे भर को ये दुनिया जुल्म छोड़ देती है. लम्हे भर को सब पत्थर मुस्कुराने लगते हैं. जब भी चूम लेता हूँ इन हसीन आंखों को, सौ चराग अंधेरे में झिल मिलाने लगते हैं.
Whenever I kiss these lovely eyes, 100 lamps light up in the dark. Be it a flower or a bud, the moon or the stars, my rivals all concede defeat. Time-stilled statues break out in dance. Ancient caves, long silent, sing their songs. Desolate gardens bloom once more. Clouds make peace with arid earth. For a moment, the world gives up all cruelty. For a moment, the world gives up all cruelty. For a moment, hard stones crease into soft smiles.
अब अगली नज़्म है, ये मुझे बहुत पसंद है क्योंकि ये मेरी ज़ाती एक्सपीरियंस है. दरअसल होता क्या था कि this was a scene I used to see every single day in my house. My mother would wear a crisp cotton sari in the morning, collect the har singar, jiska parichat kehte hain, those flowers, you know, the one with the orange stems and the beautiful fragrance, and she would put it in a wicker basket and she would arrange it, and then the tea ceremony would start. Tea was a ceremony in our house always, and then Abba would come and sit, and they would have their morning, whether it was about the news or whether it would be about, if she was rehearsing for a play, then he would give her her cues, etc. It was a very intimate, very special moment in which the children also somehow by a process of osmosis felt that this is something that is their time. So this is something that I would see almost every day. And this continues to be a very favorite poem of mine. Ek lamha. Zindagi naam hai kuch lamhon ka. Aur unme bhi wahi ek lamha. Jisme do bolti aankhein. चाय की प्याली से जब उठे तो दिल में डूबे, डूब के दिल में कहें, आज तुम कुछ न कहो, आज मैं कुछ न कहूं. बस यूं ही बैठे रहें, हाथ में हाथ लिए, गम की सौगात लिए, गर्मी ये जज्बात लिए. कौन जाने किसी लम्हे में दूर पर्वत पे कहीं बर्फ पिघलने ही लगे. तो इससे पहले कि सुमंत्रो अपना तर्जुमा सुनाए, देयर समथिंग दैट आई नीड टू शेयर विद यू. माई ब्रदर इज वेरी नॉटी मैन ऑफ कोर्स, एंड ही ऑलवेज सेज कि ये पोएम क्यों लिखी गई थी. मैं बताऊँ, माई मदर इज अ वेरी टॉकेटिव वुमन एंड माई फादर वॉज गिवन टू लॉन्ग साइलेंसेस. सो बाबा मेरा भाई है, वो कहता है कि ये नज्म अब्बा ने इसलिए लिखी थी इस उम्मीद के साथ कि मे बी अ डे विल कम वेयर आज तुम कुछ ना कहो नहीं हो. लेकिन वो ये ख्वाहिश लेकर ही गए क्योंकि ऐसा सिर्फ नज्म तक लिमिटेड रहा. जी सुमंत्र.
A moment. What we call life is but a moment or two. In one of those moments, two eyes meet, seeming to speak, looking up from a cup of tea, and drown in the flux of their hearts. Drowning, they say, let us not speak overmuch. Let us say not a word. Let us sit thus hand in hand, with grief a gift, and the tumult of these feelings. Who knows but at this very moment, somewhere in the distant mountains, the snow has begun to thaw.
Aurat is an iconic poem of Kaifi. It was written almost 70 years ago at a time when it was believed that it's for the woman to stay in the kitchen and look after the food and the children, and it's for the man to go out and struggle. And Kaifi, 70 years ago, instead asks his woman to stand up and walk shoulder to shoulder with him. This was the poem that my mother heard in Hyderabad, which was the first time she'd set eyes on him, and decided, all on her own, that this poem was written for her. And so, of course, she's going to marry this man, but it did happen that they got married. तो इसके कुछ बंद हैं जो हम सुनाएंगे. उठ मेरी जान, मेरे साथ ही चलना है तुझे. जिंदगी जहद में है, सब्र के काबू में नहीं. नब्जे हस्ती का लहू कांपते आंसू में नहीं. उड़ने खुलने में है निखत खमे गेसू में नहीं. जन्नत एक और है जो मर्द के पहलू में नहीं. उसकी आजाद रविश पर भी मचलना है तुझे. उठ मेरी जान, मेरे साथ ही चलना है तुझे.
Rise, my love, you must walk along with me. The sparks of conflict are all about us. Sorry, that's a different stanza. Walk, rise, my love, walk along with me. Life lies in struggle, not in endurance, not in the shimmer of tears, but in the throb of the vein. Don't hide your fragrance in temperate tresses, but let the wind carry it everywhere. There is a heaven beyond a man's embrace. Independence demands a different dance. Rise, my love, walk along with me.
Qadr ab tak teri tareekh ne jaani hi nahi. Qadr ab tak teri tareekh ne jaani hi nahi. Tujh mein shole bhi hain, bas ashpishani hi nahi. Tu haqeeqat bhi hai, dilchasp kahani hi nahi. तेरी हस्ती भी है, एक चीज जवानी ही नहीं. अपनी तारीख का उन्वान बदलना है तुझे. उठ मेरी जान, मेरे साथ ही चलना है तुझे.
The times are yet to give you your due. You are fire, not just the damp of tears. You are real, not just a charming tale. Your life outlives your youth. It is time to write your own story. Rise, my love, walk along with me.
तोड़ कर रस्म के बुत बंदे कदामत से निकल. जोफे इशरत से निकल, वहमे नजाकत से निकल. नफ्स के खेचे हुए हलके अजमत से निकल. कैद बन जाए मोहब्बत तो मोहब्बत से निकल. राह का खार ही क्या, गुल भी कुचलना है तुझे. राह का खार ही क्या, गुल भी कुचलना है तुझे. उठ मेरी जान, मेरे साथ ही चलना है तुझे.
break the bonds of custom, escape the binds of tradition, give up luxury, leave effeteness behind, break out of self-styled ideas of greatness. If love becomes a prison, break out of the prison of love. Trample on thorn and flower alike, rise, my love, walk along with me.
Thank you. अब जो अगली नज़म है मकान हैज़ ऑल्सो प्लेड अ वेरी बिग रोल इन माई लाइफ बिकॉज आई हैव बीन वर्किंग विद स्लम ड्वेलर्स फॉर द लास्ट 30-odd ईयर्स एंड मकान वॉज द इंस्पिरेशन फॉर दैट वर्क इट टॉक्स अबाउट द आयरनी ऑफ द कंस्ट्रक्शन वर्कर हु विद द लेबर विद हिज ओन लेबर ऑफ स्वेट एंड ब्लड works to construct this beautiful building. And once the building is made, a chowkidar is put at the gate. And this man, who has struggled and used his blood and sweat to put up that building, is not allowed to enter that very building. So Kaifi talks about opening up a window. That opening of the window is not just physically that of the building, but the opening of a window against all kinds of injustice and oppression. आज की रात बहुत गर्म हवा चलती है आज की रात बहुत गर्म हवा चलती है आज की रात न फुटपाथ पे नींद आएगी सब उठो मैं भी उठूं तुम भी उठो तुम भी उठो कोई खिड़की इसी दीवार में खुल जाएगी ये जमीन तब भी निगल लेने पे आमादा थी पांव जब टूटती शाखों से उतारे हमने इन मकानों को खबर है न मकीनों को खबर उन दिनों की जो गुफाओं में गुजारे हमने हाथ ढलते गए सांचे में तो थकते कैसे नक्श के बाद नए नक्श निखारे हमने कि ये दीवार बुलंद और बुलंद और बुलंद बामो दर और जरा और निखारे हमने आंधियां तोड़ लिया करती थी शमों की लवें जड़ दिए इसलिए बिजली के सितारे हमने बन गया कसर तो पहरे पे कोई बैठ गया बन गया कसर तो पहरे पे कोई बैठ गया सो रहे खाक पे हम शोरिशे तामीर लिए अपनी नस नस में लिए मेहनत पहम की थकन बंद आंखों में इसी कसर की तस्वीर लिए दिन पिघलता है सरों पर अब तक रात आंखों में खटकती है सिया तीर लिए आज की रात बहुत गर्म हवा चलती है आज की रात न फुटपाथ पे नींद आएगी सब उठो मैं भी उठूं तुम भी उठो तुम भी उठो कोई खिड़की इसी दीवार में खुल जाएगी
It is a hot wind that blows tonight. Sleep will not come tonight on the footpath. Let us rise, me and you as well. In this bricked space, a window will surely open. Even then, the earth was bent to swallow us whole, even as we descended from the broken branches above. What would these buildings and their inhabitants know of those our days spent in caves? There can be no let in our toil, no tiring, as we build newer and better memorials. Each door made strong, stronger still, and everywhere the mark of our skill. When the storm put out our lamps, we plucked electricity from the starry sky. Our work done, the palace built, the guards move in. We sleep in squalor still, the sounds of construction are our lullabies. Fatigue thrums in every vein, the palace loosened even within these shut eyes. The days meld into each other. The nights are of unending dark. It is a hot wind that blows tonight. Sleep will not come tonight on the footpath. Let us rise, me and you as well. In this bricked space, a window will surely open.
ہیں ان کو کہا جاتا تھا کہ وہ نظم کے شاعر ہیں, غزلیں کم کہتے تھے, لیکن یہ غزل ہے میں ڈھونڈتا ہوں جسے, وہ ہم آپ کے سامنے پیش کرتے ہیں. عام طور پہ ہوتا یہ ہے کہ جب انگریزی میں ترجمہ ہوتا ہے تو یہ کہتے ہیں کہ غزل کو ذرا الگ چھوڑ دینا چاہیے کیونکہ اس کا بالکل جو ایتھوس ہے وہ بالکل الگ ہوتا ہے. اس میں نظم میں یہ ہوتا ہے کہ دیر از ون تھاٹ اینڈ سو اٹس ایزیئر ٹو فالو. ان اے غزل یو کین ہیو سیپریٹ بنز وچ ڈونٹ نیسیسریلی ہیو اینی تھنگ ٹو ڈو ود ایچ ادر, اینڈ سو اٹس ویری پرٹیکولر ٹو دی اردو ٹریڈیشن. بٹ آئی تھنک سمانترا ہیز ریئلی ڈن اے ویری گڈ جاب ود اٹ. سو میں ڈھونڈتا ہوں جسے وہ جہاں نہیں ملتا, نئی زمین نیا آسماں نہیں ملتا, نئی زمین نیا آسماں بھی مل جائے نئے بشر کا کہیں کچھ نشان نہیں ملتا.
I search for a new world that I cannot find, I search for new earths, new skies I cannot find. If perchance I find them, if somewhere they be, I see in them no signs of a new humanity.
وہ تیغ مل گئی ہے جس سے ہوا ہے قتل میرا, وہ تیغ مل گئی ہے جس سے ہوا ہے قتل میرا, کسی کے ہاتھ کا اس پر نشان نہیں ملتا. وہ میرا گاؤں ہے, وہ میرے گاؤں کے چولہے, وہ میرا گاؤں ہے, وہ میرے گاؤں کے چولہے, کہ جن میں شولے تو شولے دھواں نہیں ملتا.
The sword has been found that did me in, the sword has been found that did me in, but no mark of him by whom I was slain. My village see there stoves stoked with coke, stoves that have no fire now, no sign of smoke.
Jo ek khuda nahi milta to itna matam kya, jo ek khuda nahi milta to itna matam kya, مجھے خود اپنے قدم کا نشان نہیں ملتا. جو ایک خدا نہیں ملتا تو اتنا ماتم کیا, مجھے خود اپنے قدم کا نشان نہیں ملتا. کھڑا ہوں کب سے میں چہروں کے ایک جنگل میں, کھڑا ہوں کب سے میں چہروں کے ایک جنگل میں, تمہارے چہرے کا کچھ بھی یہاں نہیں ملتا. میں ڈھونڈتا ہوں جسے وہ جہاں نہیں ملتا, نئی زمین نیا آسماں نہیں ملتا.
With no God in evidence, why should we mourn? With no God in evidence, why should we mourn? Even the mark of my own footprint is gone. I have stood long amidst this wilderness of faces. I have stood long amidst this wilderness of faces. But I find no trace of your face or your graces. I search for a new world that I cannot find. I search for new earths, new skies I cannot find.
اب سمانترا نے یہ سوچا تھا کہ کچھ کیفی صاحب کی فلم کے گانے بھی اس میں شامل ہونے چاہیے, کیونکہ ریئلی دوز ڈیز واز اسپیشل وین یو ہیڈ مجرو اینڈ یو ہیڈ ساحر اینڈ یو ہیڈ جان سر اختر اینڈ کیفی اینڈ چلیندر اینڈ آل دیٹ. ایون دا فلم سانگز ور ایکچولی پوئمز. ناؤ واٹ یو ہیو از اللہ میاں کچھ سنا آپ کو؟
او مائی گاڈ
میں کچھ سنا. اچھا اس کا تو ٹرانسلیشن کر کے بتائی دو. میں تندوری مرغ ہوں, مجھے گٹکا دے الکوہل کے ساتھ. بتائیے اس کا کیا
فون لگا.
تو یہ بہت دلچسپ قصہ ہے کہ یہ گانا لکھا کیسے گیا. کیفی صاحب یہ کہتے تھے کہ فلم انڈسٹری میں یہ رول ہے کہ پہلے دھن بنتی ہے, پہلے ٹیون بنتی ہے اور اس کے بعد اس پہ الفاظ فٹ کیے جاتے ہیں. یہ بالکل ایسا ہے کہ جیسے پہلے آپ نے قبر کھود دی اور اس کے بعد اس میں مردہ فٹ کرنے کی کوشش کی, تو کبھی مردے کا پاؤں باہر ہوتا اور کبھی سر. مگر کیفی کو کام اس لیے ملنے لگا کیونکہ لوگ سمجھنے لگے کہ وہ مردے اچھے گاڑ لیتے ہیں. اب ہوا یہ تھا کہ دے ور ورکنگ فار دس بیوٹیفل فلم کاغذ کے پھول, اینڈ ایس ڈی برمن just came up with a tune, and right there, Kaifi wrote the first band for it. And the problem was that there was no situation for it. But Gurudat was so enamored of the song that he said, aap isko complete kar lijiye, main iske liye situation bana dunga. Aur is tarah se wo bana. Waqt ne kiya kya hasi se tam. Tum rahe na tum, hum rahe na hum. Beqarar dil is tarah mile, jis tarah kabhi hum juda na the. Tum bhi kho gaye, hum bhi kho gaye, ek raah mein chal ke do kadam. Jayenge kahan, soochta nahi, chal pade magar raasta nahi, kya talash hai, kuch pata nahi, bun rahe hai dil, khab dam badam, waqt ne kiya kya hasi sitam, tum rahe na tum, hum rahe na hum.
With what sweet irony did time pass us by? You stayed not you, I stayed not I. Two restless hearts, and then we met and felt we were never separate. You lost your way, I lost my way. A few steps together and we went astray. Where shall we go now? Tell me where. The road we stepped out on isn't there. What are we searching for? Tell me what. My heart weaves dreams still. That's all I've got. With what sweet irony did time pass us by? You stayed not you. I stayed not I.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it.
As we can. I'd like to start by asking about the theme and not so much the man. What is the role of culture in times like these?
Essential, in a word. I think the idea of culture, I think at any time, is essential, because I think it transmutes in a way the times and makes a distillation of what is right or wrong with those times, if that culture and that art is actually worth its name. I think it does that. And it therefore becomes both, I think, a critique as well as a light. It is not an answer, but I think it is a revelation. And I think that in the line between being revelation and being an answer lies culture, for me.
Would it be accurate to say, and perhaps you can add to what he just did, that the liberalism that is expressed on social and political issues in Hollywood tends not to happen in our part of the world? And if not, then why not?
Actually, I want to make a sweeping generalization like this, because we must remember that in India, not even starting with the progressive writers movement, but that was a very important part of it. Protest poetry, art, social change, all of that, we've had a history and a tradition of that. We've had it through the progressive writers, we've had it through IPTA, we've had that through many movements. You are specifically talking about films, I guess. And the atmosphere is very different. You see, in Hollywood, you can have Meryl Streep openly criticizing Trump. You can have Robert De Niro saying that the sooner we get rid of Trump, the better it is. And in no way does that reflect on their career. In India, it's not like that. In India, 10 people can get up and say that they have an objection to this, and the film can be pulled off the theaters. Which means basically the rule of law isn't as strong here. Because what I fail to understand is once a film has been passed by the Board of Film Certification, which is the only regulatory body. How can 10 people get up and stop the film from being made and say that I'm going to cut off the nose of the leading lady and get away with it? You have an instance like that. Then you have an instance when so much money is riding on the film that filmmakers just can't take the risk. They cannot take the risk that because of a statement that they've made, the film will not be shown in this territory or that territory. So the cross that you have to bear is much, much more difficult in terms of the money that is at stake.
And this is something that, you know, both of you can take in turn. Would it be accurate to say that what we just saw was a reflection of, in some ways, a better, more open time? Would this be possible for somebody to be so directly associated with a political party to also be a major contributor to a popular culture?
See, Akar, I think that it was both an open and a closed time. As, for example, in the film itself, you realize that somebody like Patel bans the Communist Party of India. So for the people at that point, for Shaukat Kaifi at that point, it was a very closed time. And she had no love lost for Mr. Patel. But I think these things are comparative and relative. And I think that what we are seeing now, to me, is a dark, dark time for me personally. And I think that these become personal relationships with what is happening in the world around you. So I'm not sure that I speak for everybody. Obviously, I don't. Otherwise, it wouldn't be such a dark time. But yes, I think that it is becoming more and more difficult to be a Kaifi Azmi today, and therefore it's becoming more and more necessary.
And tell me, again, just to add something, you've been in the industry, I think, 40 years. Shama would have been 1980 or thereabouts. Have you noticed a change? You've been an activist, if I may call you that, for at least 3.5 decades. Have you noticed a change in our country and the way that we respond to popular culture and its robust engagement with politics and what we can call difficult issues?
You know, just take the film Fire. It was made in 1997. At that time, it was pulled out of the theatres because the Shiv Sena decided that they would take political mileage out of it. But it went back into the theatres. And it went back into the theatres because it was civil society that got up and had many, many spontaneous demonstrations in which they said that we will not have a political party decide for us what we are going to watch, what we are going to read, what we are going to see when it has gone through the due process. And it was really civil society that made such a hue and cry about it that the film went back into the theatres. Where is that civil society today, I'd like to know? Where is it? What are we doing about it? You see, it's said that if you put a frog in boiling water, it jumps out and saves itself. But if you put a frog in tepid water and slowly turn the heat on, the frog doesn't realize and dies. What is happening is that we are seeing the temperature being heated up and we are still going around behaving as if it's going to be okay.
And is this the silence of the many or the few who were more vocal earlier and it is the many who are now speaking? How does one sort of understand this this change?
I don't know what you mean by that sentence.
I mean that, were we a different people 30, 40 years ago? And were many more of us willing to stand up for something that we felt was right? And we are.
I think we didn't have the cost to bear for it. If we stood up and dissension was something that was absolutely accepted and it was done till very recently. I remember when I was in Parliament, Atal Bihari Vajpayee was the Prime Minister and I used to regularly get up. I mean, I'm not involved with any party politics at all. I was a nominated member of Parliament And I used to have many reservations, and I would express my thoughts. In no way did it impact my relationship with Atal Bihari Vajpayee. In fact, what I used to love about Parliament at that time, it was different for me, is that I would see people standing in the house and shout each other down so much so that I would worry that one of them will kill the other. And then after that, we would go into the central hall and everybody would talk to everybody and say, chalo, chalo, tum dokla khilao aur tum chai pilao. And for me, it was very, very learning and wonderful. Because you see, in the film industry, you tend to have sides. Ye aap inke group mein chale gaye to unke group se baat nahi karte. And that was not there at all, which I thought was such a marvelous thing. It's only in recent times that you're seeing that you are only going according to party lines. Now, in a democracy, if you start going only on party lines, then what is debate all about? If you are from a political party, and I'm from a political party, and you have been told that this is what your attitude is going to be on this bill, so what is this charade of having a debate at all? For whom? Because you can make the most forceful argument. Do you think you're going to be able to change anybody's mind if it is up to the party line? That's what I'm talking about. These are larger issues.
Tell me, this will be my last question. I'll come to the audience after this. Could you just lay the background for the progressives and tell us very briefly what they were and why it is that we had high culture coming into the film industry? It doesn't seem normal. It's certainly not normal today to have people with a background in poetry and reading to come into films.
I'm not really a historian, but I'll say this much, is that there was a fabulous gathering of intellect and talent. Part of it is mentioned in the film. Bombay drew these people because Bombay was doing a lot of printing at that time, working a lot with Urdu literature in journals and magazines, which needed feeding. And that was a kind of magnet, and people thought of Bombay even then as a kind of large exposure city in India. So from the smaller towns, they gravitated towards there. Of course, it started off actually in a Chinese restaurant in London, as you may know. Where three or four people gathered and they began to try and see what should literature be doing? What was the purpose of literature? And these questions are foolishly asked from time to time and intelligently answered at length. And so everybody disagreed with everybody else. Until Premchand wrote this fabulous foreword for the 1936 meeting of the progressives, and so many people agreed because they were moved, I think, by a unity of idealism. And when I say that, I'm saying that one of the cruxes of that thing was nationalism. Nationalism, I think, was predominant, but that quickly led to dealing with social inequity, and that became a very strong part of what they thought as a group and what they believed as artists. I think what happened, Akar, is that this kind of idealism which spurred, and most of them were young. They were young, they were hot-blooded, they were passionate, but they were thinking people. I think we have lots of passion and hot blood at the moment. I'm not sure about the thought. But that dissipated as well when individual egos took over, and you began to see how the human very often corrupts the ideal.
The poet in this film seems to be fairly comfortable with the idea of nationalism and about writing on war and on violence. How do you think he would have perceived times like this, when that word has perhaps a darker shade than it did in...
I think Shabana is better placed to answer that, because she knows her father intimately. and I only know him vicariously and, you know, from a distance.
See, the idea of nationalism as espoused by the Progressive Writers Association had a different definition from what it has now. And nationalism was an embracing of India's composite culture, of her pluralism, of celebrating her diversity. What is happening now is that an attempt is being made to change the very notion of nationalism. Patriotism, we must realize, is different from nationalism. And the kind of nationalism that is being at least attempted at the moment is where dissent is taken, criticism as taken as anti-national. Now, surely this augurs very badly for a democracy. Because what is a democracy if dissent isn't an essential part of it? You need not agree. But I'm not saying that my way of thinking is the correct way of thinking. Your way of thinking, I have an economic policy which is different. You have an economic policy that is different. I'm not saying that you're doing it because you're a wicked person. You have a different point of view. Now, we should be able to discuss it. Because contesting voices, I think, are very important in any framework. Contesting voices, particularly because we are a pluralistic society. So this,
what is happening,
I would again say that we are like the frogs in tepid water.
I think it would be accurate to say that those of us who have been reading and watching things like this can objectively say that out of the film industry, it's usually Shabana Azmi, Javed Akhtar,
the usual suspects.
What has that affected your career in the way that you explained careers were actually affected?
You know, fortunately, that hasn't happened. Fortunately, that hasn't happened, and I'm very grateful for that. But let me tell you that this is not the only time that this seems to be happening. I mean, there was a time during the Babri Masjid demolition when, if you please, there were people from the film industry, there were 10 very big producers who were given a diktat by the government, and they signed it, in which they said, there will not be rapes in temple, there will not be this, there will not be there. Shabana Azmi, taking my name, will not make any comment on Babri Masjid. And they signed it. 10 people. And then, of course, Javed threw a blue fit and said, who the hell are you people and how dare you do it? So, it's not that this is completely new. There are always efforts in it. So, let's not think of this as, oh God, but there will be power, and power will try to manipulate and misuse, and then contesting voices will try and overthrow it, and then the cycle will continue.
A thank you from me and from many of us who look to you and to your courage, and I think we're very fortunate to have people like you in a popular cinema.
There's one thing I want to tell you. You see, it was the Congress Party at the center, and Kaifisaab had been given a Padma Shri, and they had been asking for second language status for Urdu in UP. And the UP minister said that anybody who's asking for second language status, uska muh kala karke gadhe par usko bitha kar aur pure shahar mein ghumana chahiye. Kaifi returned his Padma Shri to the Congress government. Nobody said ki ye award wapsi gang hai, ki ye pura gang ban gaya hai. Nobody. It was accepted as the right of an artist. They tried to dissuade him. He said, no, I have been given this because of my contribution to Urdu. And if you have an elected representative who can get away with saying it, I don't want the award. That's the kind of atmosphere I'm talking about.
Well, could we have the microphone circulated, please? Perhaps we can take two or three questions.
Then he would be sitting on my sofa with Pilu Modi and would be spouting whatever he wanted. And then he would come into All India Radio and continue spouting whatever he wanted. But there was never any malice. You know, my mother would disagree. People in All India Radio would disagree. His girlfriend, we would try to... But there was never any malice. And that's all I really want to say, like what you said. And Sushma Swaraj would sit in Parliament and call Mrs. Gandhi all kinds of Italian names. But then go outside and call them and invite them for her marriage and the marriages in the family. And it is, I think Mrs. Alba also said the same thing, that whatever arguments, like you said, happened in Parliament, outside in Central Hall, like you said, people would just have a different sense of her.
Thank you very much. Can we have some questions, please?
Yes.
And if you have a question, could you put your hand up at this point? So, we have only one microphone.
Do you want this mic? I can share his.
I've taught political science for a long time and know the ins and outs, and I've appreciated your question in Parliament. I think what has happened now, and if you can also comment on it, there's a brute majority which was never seen in this light now. And therefore, I think there is a fear. There is also another thing, I'm kind of compressing it, and that is lack of total opposition in any form, civil society or within Parliament, and also the feeling that there is hardly any...
Thank you very much. If you have a question, put your hand up, please. We can have comments later. Go ahead, please.
Isn't it a continuation of what we saw earlier between Ranade and Gokhale on one side and Tilak on the other? As Shabana ji just now said, that what is happening now is not exactly new. This is one question. So I think the roots go deeper. And in fact, Tilak did send people to disturb Gokhale's meeting. You would know about that, Akachi.
Would it be true to say this is not very new, that the phase we've been going through since 92, but particularly in the last 10 or so years, is just a continuation of what we've seen for the last...
Isn't this a culmination of that process? Secondly, the Progressive Writers Association, apart from the ego clashes, isn't the increasing difference between Hindi and Urdu, because Premchand represented a synthesis of both. For example, Manto, Ahmed Nadeep, Kasmi, Miradi, etc., they broke away, even if they were not with the movement from the beginning. But ego clashes apart, isn't this a larger issue which led to the decline of Progressive Writers Association and the differences between Urdu and Hindi?
Would you like to take either of those questions? This is not new, this is just a continuation.
No, I don't think that it was a difference between Hindi and Urdu, because it was never looked upon as that. It was looked upon as Hindustani. And we had great pride in the Hindustani language, which had Urdu in it also, and it had Hindi also in it. You have to see that after partition, of course, an attempt was made to relegate Urdu to the language of the religion, which of course is wrong, because languages can't belong to religions, they belong to regions. And Urdu was the language of North India. It had nothing to do with Islam, because in Tamil Nadu, you don't see that the Tamilian Muslim speaks Urdu. Ye baat nahi thi. Lekin differences ye the, there was a very strong group that felt that they have to do art for social change, use instrument as art for social change. And a breakaway group came that said that this actually limits art, because there is a very great validity in saying art for art's sake. And I have no problems with that view. But they said that, the critics of the Progressive Writers said that their art was becoming fixated in time because it was protest, and that it wouldn't stand the test of time. I wish that were true. I wish that it needn't have stood the test of time. Unfortunately, every single issue that was raised by them continues to be valid even today. And that's why you will need that voice.
I was wondering what I would choose from Garam Hawa, and what I ended up choosing was a Muslim man looking for a house and not finding it. That was 1947. This is 2019. Yeah.
Isn't the microphone is here somewhere?
Yes. Simple question. What were your father's relations with modernism, specifically Muhammad Hasan Askari and Shamsur Rahman Faruqi and Shabkhul? As you know, they're on that particular group of writers didn't take the same view of...
They used to take it in their stride. Let me tell you, each one of them had a huge ego. The wo inke sariyat se milte the, and they would be very polite, but in their hearts think that person is talking nonsense. And of course we are right, which is the way it always is. But it never expressed itself in any misbehavior with each other. They would talk to each other with great courtesy, but in their heart think ye sab galat hai, jaise ki sab artists karte. Acha, ek baat please, I do want to get back. I know it's very important because the film raises all these issues, but I would like a couple of questions on the film itself. And the fact that, listen, you can't go away only thinking of Kaifi Azmi, because Shaukat Kaifi is a tremendous woman and he would not have been able to do half the work he did. And you can see how feisty and wonderful she is.
Actually, I actually wanted to ask that because everything was going around, which was also important, you know. Poetry and politics has been in hand in hand all through, and I am now curious about, I think your mom is the only strong woman who is seen in the film. Beyond that, of course she is part of making film. Otherwise, you know, out of the family, you hardly see any women. That is one thing. The other one is, when you made this film, the team, whoever made the film, it looks like you wanted at this point of time to direct this relationship of poetry and politics, which is very essential, as a kind of a voice of resistance, or also Kaifi Azmi and his involvement, which also shows us a kind of weaving history. So what was it behind the making of this film at this point of time in history?
Thank you.
I'm not quite sure I've got what you're saying, except to try and understand. I think what you're saying is that... I don't know what you're saying. But maybe we're talking about the relevance of the interplay of poetry and politics. And in today's time, did I do this with an intention to make a comment on today's time? If that's the question, no, I didn't. If that comment happens, it's because we're struggling with so many of the same problems. It's because some of those problems have intensified and amplified. And therefore, I think Kaifi's voice and the voice of the poets of that era are still resonating in a way that they shouldn't be resonating, in the way that they should have been relegated to the past. They're resonating because the problems haven't gone away as they should have, and are getting worse, I think. So the voices of reason, the voices of humanism, and I think Kaifi's voice above all is the voice of a humanist. And that's what we need. We need that more and more.
Can I ask? So I'm quite interested. Can I ask a question?
Go ahead.
Post 64, you know, the film says that your father was broken by the split in the Communist Party. So post 1964, I think you're referring to the 1964 split. What was his relationship with the Communist Party? One. And secondly, what was your mother's relationship with the Communist Party? Because there is a point in the movie where she says how the party had asked her to have an abortion when she was expecting you. So throughout, what was her association? Did she have an independent relationship? And post 64, what was your father's links?
But Kaifi was heartbroken when the Communist Party split into two. He was absolutely, I think it was the lowest point in his life. But, you know, he was such a devoted Communist Party worker, such a devoted party worker, that he didn't really actually go out and fight with them. It came out through his poetry. And he was a great fan of P.C. Joshi and was very disappointed with Randive and all of that. But he carried on. He was disappointed. He was heartbroken. But he carried on. Mummy was and is a great admirer of many of the policies of the Congress, of the Communist Party. But obviously, she was very hurt when they asked her to abort me. Imagine what a loss it would have been to see. And there was a time. You see, my mother has some priorities which are completely different from anything else, and that is her love for saris, basically. So when this thing happened, you know, when they went to, I'm sorry, I'm just diverting a little bit, but it's a nice incident. She is passionately fond of good saris. And she loved Indira Gandhi because Indira Gandhi wore very beautiful saris. And the cottage industry in that time was doing very well. That's what she was concerned about. I used to think that the divorce will happen because she used to defend Indira Gandhi in front of my husband. And she would say, "Main tumhari koi chamchi nahi hu, aur main koi CPI ki member nahi hu. Mujhe jo bolna hai, wo to main bolungi." Now, when Kaifi and his delegation went to Rajiv Gandhi to ask for second language status for Urdu again. So my mother actually believed, she said, "Main peeche baithi hui thi, aur phir Kaifi ne kaha ki ye Shaukat hai meri biwi, aur Rajiv Gandhi ne palat ke dekha. Aur unhone kya dekha? Ke maine wohi saari pehni thi, dusri saari sirf Indira Gandhi ke paas thi, to unhone kaha, de do inko second language status." Aisa original to aapko kabhi, but she was completely convinced about it.
Yes, sir.
नमस्कार शबाना जी.
नमस्कार.
मैं भी उत्तर प्रदेश ईस्टर्न यूपी के रहने वाला हूँ, इलाहाबाद का, तो थोड़ा आजमगढ़ आना जाना काफ़ी रहता है. नाउ जैसे कि फिल्म में दिखाया कि आपके हवाले साहब ने आखिरी टाइम पे काफ़ी समय वहाँ पे वहाँ गुजारा, और ये बहुत ही अच्छी बात है. तो मेरा सवाल ये है कि क्या आप भी आजमगढ़ जाके और कुछ आप काम करना चाहेंगे या फिर आप वहाँ रहना चाहेंगे? बिकॉज वो काफ़ी एक इस तरह की बेल्ट है जो कि काम बहुत करना है वहाँ पे, आप प्रोग्रेसिव नहीं हो पाते हैं, और मैं उधर अक्सर जाता रहता हूँ और गया भी हूँ. तो क्या आप वहाँ जाके तो आप रहना चाहेंगे और कुछ तो आप काम करना चाहेंगे वाले साहब की तरह?
थैंक यू.
अब्बा को गुजर के 15 साल हो गए हैं, और उनके बाद मिजमा वेलफेयर सोसाइटी जो उन्होंने फाउंड की थी, इस सोच के साथ कि अगर हिंदुस्तान को वाकई तरक्की की तरफ बढ़ना है तो हमको अपने गांव की तरफ देखना पड़ेगा. और तो उन्होंने मिजमा वेलफेयर सोसाइटी बनाई विद अ कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑन वुमेन एंड द गर्ल चाइल्ड थ्रू एजुकेशन एंड फाइनेंशियल इंडिपेंडेंस एंड एट्सेट्रा. I have been at the helm of Mijwa Welfare Society, and if you come to Mijwa and if you come and see the transformation that has taken place, I'm very happy with that. Ek main aapko sirf example de dun ke it used to be common for girls as young as 12 to get married, and they used to come with sindoor in their mangs. And it was because of the kind of training that they got at the Kaifi Azmi school that one day they had to go and perform a play in Jaipur. It was the first time they'd ever left Mijwa in their lives. They went to Jaipur, they took part in an interstate competition, and they came first the play that they had written was against dowry, which they had written just with the help of their vice principal. Now, when this girl came back, she was 15 years old, she called for an assembly. She called all the principal, the students, and the staff, and she said, this award that I've won is not merely an award, but it is my passport to freedom. On the basis of this award, I am now going to struggle with my parents and say, I want to do my own thing and I refuse to get married before the age of 18. She got all the children to take a prana, including the principal, that if any girl is being forced into marriage before the age of 18, they will go and do a demonstration outside that person's house and make sure it doesn't happen. And today, not only in Mijwa, but in 40 villages around it, there is not a single instance of child marriage. So this is a transformation. You see, it's a mindset transformation. What Kaifi always worked for, we can put up any number of buildings, any number of infrastructure, but what you have to work with is the mindset change. And you today can noticeably see that there is a mindset change. I think that's important.
Last question. I'm Vikram. And I'd like to share with you my interaction with Kaifisaab. He used to come back from HMA in Delhi. I used to meet him. And I must share with you, since I'm the last person to come in, the sensitivity. And I look at his poetry as a pedagogy. And I must tell you, when I asked him once, first of all, let me tell you how simple he was. He used to live in Bahadur Shah Zafar Marg in that Communist Party guest house in the heat of Delhi in late June. He used to return from Azamgarh after those small mangoes would drop. And he would say that, I asked him once, why don't you come home for dinner? So he agreed. You know, when I went to his place, there was no air conditioner. There was that hot loo of Delhi and there was a fan. And he had already gone through this paralytic attack. So when I took him home, I asked him this question, ki Kaifi Saab, aapka sabse achha gana kaun sa hai? Why I'm saying it is because I consider him to be valid today. And he very jokingly with a disarming smile told me, Bhai Vikram, jiske pure paise mil jaye film industry mein, wohi sabse achha gana hai. Having said that,
I think we should take a question at the end.
I want to narrate something because it's important in the context. Then he told me a song I wrote, which is a pedagogy, and he said, I wrote that song for children. And I just narrate to you a few words of that. And that why I'm saying it is because he could say that in such simple terms for a child. He said, I wrote a song for children in a film and it went something like this. Ek, do, teen, char, aur, panch, chhe, aur, saat, aath, aur, no. Ek jagah sab rehte the, jhagde bhar the, var unme so. No ne kaha, aat se tu kon? Aat ne saat ko dhutkara. Aur aakhir mein reh gaya, ek aur sifar bechara. जब वो दोनों एक दूसरे के साथ मिले तो वो बन गए 10 और उससे एक नया जीवन शुरू हुआ. The point I'm trying to make
कागज के फूल का गाना बहुत अच्छा
गाना. And he said it was his best song because I thought he would say
thank you. Could you pass the microphone to the gentleman to your right? Thank you.
Namaste Shabana ji. Namaste everybody on the stage. What has been the impact of the current political situation on Mijwan? And how has the current dispensation impacted on life in Mijwan today?
Thank you. And that will be our last question.
So far, it's been good. So far, there hasn't been any interruption because we've really not taken any help from the government. But the administration in Azamgarh and all that are all very good because they're very proud of the work. But I know that was the last question, but I want to finish on one thing which people didn't know too much about Kaifi. Kaifi had a great sense of humor and deadpan. Okay, I'll give you an example. I was once putting eye drops in his eyes, and he had the tiniest little eyes in the world. And so every time I would try to put the eye drop, he'd blink and it would fall and it would go somewhere else. And I tried 3-4 times, then he said, अच्छा मैं तुमको एक कहानी सुनाता हूँ. मैंने कहा अच्छा. तो उन्होंने कहा एक राजा था, उसका एक इंतहाई नामाकूल बेटा था. वो कुछ भी नहीं कर सकता था, तो उन्होंने अपने वजीर से कहा कि भैया ये शहजादे को कुछ तो हुनर सिखा दो. तो वजीर ने कहा कि अच्छा लेट मी टीच हिम आर्चरी, कि मैं तीर चलाना सिखाऊं. अब उससे हुआ ये कि जब वो
शहजादे ने तीर चलाना शुरू किया तो वो पूरा पैलेस तहस नहस हो गया, उसके पूरे शैंडेलियर्स खत्म हो गए, एवरीथिंग वेंट डाउन. सो देन नाउ द फादर गॉट वेरी स्कैर्ड एंड सेड दैट आई एम रियली वरिड फॉर माय लाइफ, हाउ विल आई सेव माय सेल्फ बिकॉज दिस एरो इज गोइंग एनी विच वे. सो द वजीर सेड, यू नो व्हाट वी कैन डू, वी कैन स्टैंड सेंटर स्टेज ऑफ द टारगेट, द एरो विल गो एवरीवेयर बट इट वॉन्ट गो देयर. सो आई लुक्ड एट हिम एंड आई सेड, तो इसे तुम अपनी तरफ से आई ड्रॉप्स मेरे कान में डालो, वो सीधी तरह से मेरे
थैंक यू टू ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर कमिंग ऑन द बीएससी मैथ्स सुमंत्रा घोषाल एंड शबाना अजमी.